Hello friends, this is Dr. Rajal Shah. Today in this particular video, I would like to talk about the benign mimickers of prostate cancer, a very important topic when you deal with prostate needle biopsies. This is a relatively big topic, so I'm going to break down that into three parts. In this particular video, I will talk about my overall general approach towards the diagnosis of benign mimickers of prostate cancer. So in a previous video of a dummies guide to prostate cancer diagnosis, I have emphasized on a three-step approach towards prostate cancer diagnosis. And in this three-step approach, if a particular lesion shows you architectural and cytological atypia, then the last step that you have to make sure that you rule out is various benign mimickers which are known to give you architectural and cytological atypia. So again, I want to emphasize here that this is an integrated three-step approach. We are not going to look at one particular step in light of missing other particular steps. Also, we are going to keep benign glands as your reference point. These are very, very important kind of points to keep in mind. And the reason for that is that benign mimickers are known to give you several architectural and cytological atypia. And here is the list. On the right side, you have various benign mimickers of prostate cancer. And on the left side, you see different type of low power architectural and high power cytological atypical features. But it is very important not to get stuck on this one particular atypical feature when you encounter a lesion. When you look that in the context of all these three steps that I emphasize, then you can make usually a confident diagnosis of these different lesions, benign mimickers of prostate cancer, and can come to a more confident approach towards prostate cancer diagnosis. A useful method to classify the benign mimickers of prostate cancer is based on its architectural pattern. So based on this architectural pattern, the benign mimickers can be divided into those which mimic low-grade prostate cancer, so essentially mimickers of Gleason pattern 3, and then high-grade benign mimickers which mimic high-grade prostate cancer, so essentially mimickers of Gleason pattern 4 and 5 prostate cancer. Well-formed glands typically would be the majority of your mimickers that you are going to deal with. There are numerous anatomical variations as well as pathophysiological conditions, proliferative lesions. I have talked about two separate videos, including Dr. Ming Zhao, my colleague, who has given a nice video on cribriform pattern in prostate needle biopsy interpretation. So those two videos essentially talk about the mimickers, cribriform mimickers of prostate cancer. So I'm not going to talk about that in a separate video, but I will make a second video on small glandular mimics of prostate cancer. And then the third video would be focused on these high grade patterns other than cribriform pattern for prostate cancer. So those will be done separately, and please watch out for those videos in a later date. As a rule, there are several architectural and cytological features that you can look for in a particular lesion. These particular features are not necessarily specific for a particular entity, but in my opinion, in my experience, I have found them extremely valuable, and they are useful clues towards suggesting a benign diagnosis of prostate in prostate biopsy. So let us review these various architectural and cytological features, which in general would provide you a clue towards a benign diagnosis. So number one, low power analysis. So when at low architectural analysis, when you see a lesion which has a nice lobulated or tightly circumscribed proliferation Like this example, it usually suggests a benign diagnosis. This is a nice example of Cowper's glands, where you see this dimorphic population of glands with abundant mucin and then central duct-like structures. But pay attention to its architecture, very tightly circumscribed proliferation. This is usually a mimicker of foamy gland prostate adenocarcinoma, and cancer usually never presents with such a tight circumscribed proliferation. So this rule applies for most of the benign conditions, but you have to also be aware about certain atypical architectural variations which are known to happen with various lesions. And notable amongst them is atrophy. Atrophy can present with sometimes patch-like growth pattern, which has been also referred to as a pseudo-infiltrative growth pattern. And then partial atrophy and some other benign mimics can notably present with very haphazard or disorganized growth pattern. But it is very important to keep in mind that these two patterns, which I have described as an architectural atypia, they are not infiltrative pattern, which is typically characteristic of prostate cancer. The next important feature is to pay careful attention to adjacent benign glands as a reference point. When you have small glandular proliferation, which is usually glands in question or something glands which can give you an atypical presentation, when these small atypical glands have essentially similar cytological and cytoplasmic characteristics, it usually suggests a benign lesion. Here is a nice example of adenosis, also referred to as an atypical adenomatous hyperplasia. And note here that in this particular example, these small glands essentially have a similar cytoplasmic and cytological characteristics like adjacent benign glands, pointing towards a benign diagnosis. There are many benign mimics which can present with this type of feature, but notable amongst them is adenosis, like this example, as well as partial atrophy. When a lesion shows you a reactive type of cellular spindly stroma proliferation, like this example, it usually points towards a proliferative or benign lesion. This is typically stroma that you are going to encounter in nodules of benign prostatic hyperplasia. So typically three histological variations of benign prostatic hyperplasia, notably basal cell hyperplasia, adenosis, and sclerosing adenosis, classically present with this type of cellular spindly stroma. This is a nice example of basal cell hyperplasia. Also important point to keep in mind that this is not your stromogenic prostate cancer or desmoplastic stroma. Stromogenic prostate cancer has a typically very edematous, whitish, and inflammatory type of stromal characteristics. So this is a very, very different type of stroma that you should not confuse with desmoplastic stroma. When within a gland, when nuclei occupy full cell height, that is the feature that should argue against a cancer diagnosis. So here is a nice example of a post-atrophic hyperplasia seen at a higher magnification. Typically at low power also, they are lobulated lesion, but they look pretty dark, raising concern for cancer. But they look dark here because nuclei occupy full cell height. You practically don't see any cytoplasm. Atrophic prostate cancer usually have some degree of cytoplasmic differentiation, and you would see typically a lot more cytoplasm than this type of example. Note here in this high power examination, you do see several prominent nucleoli. So if you have paid attention of this lesion in the context of architecture and this particular feature, then you would not be worried about this prominent nucleoli, which is commonly seen with various benign conditions, notably post-atrophic hyperplasia and basal cell hyperplasia. So typically three lesions that you have to keep in mind: complete atrophy, post-atrophic hyperplasia, and basal cell hyperplasia, where nuclei can typically occupy full cell height. When you have random type of cytological atypia within a gland, well-formed glands, typically when some nuclei look absolutely benign, while some nuclei look randomly markedly atypical or pleomorphic, then you have to consider about two entities. Here is a nice example of seminal vesicle, an ejaculatory duct type of epithelium. This type of nuclei within the setting of this type of seminal vesicle ejaculatory duct epithelium has also been referred to as a monster nuclei. Also note here golden brown pigment. But one more condition which can also present with this type of random degenerative cytological atypia is radiation atypia, in which glands are typically more atrophic looking, but very random type of cytological atypia can be seen. Prostate cancer, which is typically well formed like this particular well formed lesion here, they typically would have a lot more uniform cytological atypia. So keep that particular point in mind. So this is from our book, which kind of again emphasizes and kind of summarizes these different low power architectural and cytological clues that I have talked about that usually would point towards a benign diagnosis. So next time when you encounter a prostate needle biopsy, if something looks unusual, do pay attention to some of these particular features to see whether you can make a more confident diagnosis. Now let us talk about immunohistochemistry, which is commonly utilized in this type of setting. So basal cell markers are most widely utilized. Typically high molecular weight cytokeratin, cytokeratin 5, 6 and P63 are widely utilized. In general, basal cell markers have high sensitivity but low specificity for prostate cancer detection. In general, cocktail is going to give you the highest sensitivity. So the pitfalls that you have to keep in mind that several benign lesions, notably partial atrophy, adenosis and high grade pain, may demonstrate patchy positivity or may entirely lack basal cells. So this is very, very important point to keep in mind. AMSER or alpha methyl coenzyme racemase typically utilized in combination with basal cell markers in a cocktail form, which we refer to as a PIN4 stain, also demonstrate high sensitivity but low specificity for prostate cancer detection. So high grade PIN, majority of them, nephrogenic adenomas, and significant proportions of partial atrophy adenosis can express AMSER. So this is not specific to prostate cancer. Very important point to keep in mind. Now, ERG, which is a new marker in the toolbox, is highly specific for prostate cancer, but it has a much lower sensitivity for prostate cancer detection. So far it has not been detected in any benign mimics of prostate cancer, but because of its low sensitivity, it is not widely utilized for prostate cancer diagnosis, in particularly needle biopsy setting. So let us take example of this benign adenosis in needle biopsy. Note here that this particular lesion shows in very lobulated proliferation, so at low power suggests a benign diagnosis. When we look at this lesion little closely, these small glands, which are glands in question, they have similar cytoplasmic characteristic compared to these adjacent reference benign glands. So essentially similar cytoplasmic and cytological characteristics. Also note here cellular spindly stroma. So there are several features here which clearly point towards a benign adenosis diagnosis. But now this lesion stain for PIN4 multiplex immunohistochemical markers, and note here that many of these glands essentially entirely lack basal cells. But a feature to keep in mind that these glands which are lacking basal cells look identical to some of these glands which show you basal cell, patchy basal cell staining. So this is considered an acceptable basal cell staining pattern, which should not prompt you to consider this lesion as a cancer or atypical diagnosis. This is absolutely compatible with the benign diagnosis, and this is very, very important point to keep in mind. So, two ISC pulses that I would refer is that when you are dealing with a lesion, lack of basal cell staining and atypical gland by itself do not mean that you are dealing with a cancer diagnosis. You have to very carefully correlate with the morphological impression. And as I talked in the previous example, within a focus of concern, when glands that are staining for basal cells and glands that are not staining for basal cells have similar morphological characteristics, it is okay to consider that lesion as a benign, even with that type of atypical staining pattern. That's why it's also very, very important to keep in mind that you need to have a strong internal control while interpreting this basal cell immunohistochemistry. If your benign glands are lacking basal cell stain, then you cannot make much sense out of lack of basal cell staining within your focus in concern. So these are my take home messages for this particular part of my presentation. This is again from our book. I talked to you about developing a systemic approach towards prostate biopsies. Look for both low power and high power cytological features. Do not heavily rely on one feature. Use benign glands as your reference point. I think I talked about some of these features that usually would point towards a benign diagnosis. Notable amongst them is when you have glands are completely atrophic, hesitate to make a cancer diagnosis in that situation. Hesitate to make cancer diagnosis when cytoplasm and nuclear features of glands in question are essentially same as surrounding benign glands. Presence of a very cellular spindle cell stroma within a lesion typically would favor a benign proliferative process. Presence of random or scattered cytological ATPI in well-formed glands favors a benign process. Typically, well-formed prostate cancer has uniform cytological ATPI. You should know about the limitations of immunohistochemical markers. So use these markers cautiously in the setting of appropriate morphology and these limitations in mind. And make sure that stains have appropriate internal controls. There are several lesions, notably adenosis, atrophy, and high-grade pain are characterized by fragmented and patchy basal cell staining. They may even entirely lack basal cells. Majority of high-grade pain and nephrogenic adenoma and variable proportion of adenosis and partial atrophy lesions can also express AMSER. So with that note, I conclude my this particular part one presentation on benign mimickers of prostate cancer. If you like this presentation, don't forget to give me a thumbs up. I would also love to receive any of your feedback for my presentations. Thank you very much.